So now we come up with the general anatomical features of a typical long bone. And these general anatomical features of typical long bone, very simple line diagram, we are going to draw this as the typical long bone. Now this is our typical long bone. We have upper end, lower end, and the shaft of a typical long bone. Therefore, now what we shall write here will be, this will be known as the epiphysis. Here we shall write the diaphysis. Here, once again, lower end, epiphysis. Then we will mention here metaphysis, and then we will mention here, or rather we will draw, this is epiphyseal plate of cartilage. So therefore this is epiphyseal plate of cartilage, epiphyseal plate of cartilage. Now, the entire typical long bone contains these features. We start with ossification, formation of bone. Therefore, in ossification of the bone, whenever the center of ossification starts before birth, it is called primary center of ossification. And this primary center of ossification for any typical long bone will be present in the diaphysis. So diaphysis is the shaft of the long bone which will develop as primary center of ossification, which will begin its ossification before birth. Similarly, epiphysis, the two ends of the long bone, they will start their ossification after birth, and therefore they are called secondary centers of ossification. Now here, secondary centers of ossification which will develop into the epiphysis, the two ends of a typical long bone, they will always start their ossification after birth, and therefore these epiphyses, they are classified into three major categories. This is often asked as a short note, or it is asked in MCQs, classification of epiphyses. So the epiphyses will be classified into three major categories. First category will be, it is known as pressure epiphyses. Second category will be known as traction epiphyses. And third category will be known as atavistic epiphyses. Please try and understand. So we classify the epiphyses into three major parts. The first is pressure epiphysis. In the pressure epiphysis, it will transmit the pressure, or it is developing in pressure situations. So therefore, examples of pressure epiphysis will be the heads of humerus and femur, head of femur, head of humerus, as well as condyles of femur and tibia. They are examples of pressure epiphysis. These are asked as MCQs. Once again, I'll repeat. Pressure epiphysis, they will transmit pressure, and they are present to protect the epiphyseal plate of cartilage. This is the hyaline plate of cartilage. So examples will be head of the humerus and head of the femur and condyles of femur and tibia. Second, traction epiphyses. They will develop in those regions where they are subjected to traction because of the pull of certain muscles or ligaments. Example, traction. They are produced by the pull of certain muscles or ligaments. An example will be trochanters of femur as well as tubercles of humerus. Trochanters of femur and tubercles of humerus, they are traction epiphyses. Third is atavistic epiphyses. atavistic epiphysis will develop as a parasite, because they will develop, they will survive on certain other bones and they will receive their nutrition from those bones, and that is why they are called atavistic epiphysis. Examples, very strong example, atavistic epiphysis, coracoid process of scapula, please note down, coracoid process of scapula and posterior tubercle of talus bone, which is also known as os trigonum. So these are the two examples of atavistic epiphysis. Number one, coracoid process of scapula. Number two, posterior tubercle of talus, which is called os trigonum. This is often asked in MCQ. So after discussing epiphysis, we come to epiphyseal plate. This is a plate of hyaline cartilage, and it will be present in the long bones, typical long bones, which has the capacity to grow up till a certain age. So as the long bones keep on growing in length, the epiphyseal cartilage will keep on converting into the bone. And after completing their growth, the long bones, when they complete their complete growth, the epiphyseal cartilage will be replaced by the bone. It will be completely replaced by the bone. And therefore, the epiphyseal cartilage will provide for the increase in the length of the long bones. And usually after puberty, till the age of 18 years, till 20 years, this epiphyseal cartilaginous plate will completely be replaced by the bones. In females, the process of completion of length of the long bones and replacement of epiphyseal cartilage by the bones will be completed by 2 or 3 years earlier than males. So in females, this process is completed 2 or 3 years earlier than the males. That is epiphyseal plate of cartilage. Now we come to metaphyses. The portion of diaphyses towards the epiphyses or towards the epiphyseal plate is known as metaphyses. Why this portion is important is metaphyses, it is the growing end of any long bone. Metaphyses is known as the growing end. And also there will be so many branches of blood supply, so many arteries, they will have branches. For example, nutrient arteries, juxtaepiphyseal branches, juxtaepiphyseal arteries. These are the arteries which will provide branches in the metaphyses, and in the metaphyses there will be hairpin loops. And because of hairpin loops, it is more predisposed to any kind of infections. Any kind of infections can be lodged in this hairpin loops of the arteries, which will lead to various diseases. And the last important point about metaphyses will be, this is the region externally where there will be attachment of various ligaments or muscles or even capsules. So any traction to these muscles or ligaments or capsules, any shearing force may cause a breakage or it may damage the metaphyses. And now after discussing epiphyses, metaphyses, we come to the law of ossification. This law of ossification, which you need to remember it always, is the center of ossification which appears first will be the last to fuse. Once again I repeat, what is the law of ossification? The law of ossification is the center of ossification in the bone which appears first will be the last to fuse. But this rule of ossification is violated by fibula. The rule of ossification states that the center of ossification appears first, any center which appears first will be the last to fuse. It is applied to all the long bones except fibula, please note down. Fibula does not obey this rule of ossification. And lastly, in any typical long bone, the first viva question is the rule of ossification. Second viva question may be growing end of the long bones. What are the growing ends of the long bones? and there is the direction of nutrient canal. Always note down, the direction of nutrient canal will be opposite the growing ends of the long bones. For example, in case of knee joint is the growing end in lower limb. So knee joint is the growing end of typical long bone. That means knee joint is formed by lower end of femur and upper end of tibia and fibula. So lower end of femur is the growing end. Therefore, the direction of nutrient canal in which nutrient artery is present in femur will be opposite the knee joint. In case of tibia and fibula, upper end of tibia and fibula are growing end. So the direction of nutrient canal in tibia and fibula will be away from the knee joint. Same way in upper limb, the growing end is shoulder and wrist. Shoulder, upper end of the humerus is the growing end. So the direction of nutrient canal in the humerus will be towards the elbow. Wrist joint is the growing end. So therefore, lower end of the radius and ulna are the growing end. So the direction of nutrient canal in radius and ulna will be away from the wrist joint towards the elbow. So these are the small important points which you need to remember as the typical features of the long bone. So here we finish our entire typical features of the long bone. Thank you very much.